So good afternoon, everyone. We are starting our next session and the next panel of the day. The topic is the role of PPAs, power purchase agreements, in the target model. And it's a great pleasure to have with me here in this panel, I would say, the best set of speakers that we will have to discuss from a variety of, different sectors in serving this industry. Distinguished speakers like Guillaume, Dupret from Akuo Energy, Energy Market Director. Then I have Athanasios, Cholevas, Head of Global Market Solutions from National Bank of Greece. To my left, we are with Mr. Christos, CEO of Inaccess. Vasilis, Machias, Country Manager for Greece for Axpo Solutions. And digitally, I don't know if we can see Mr. Athanasopoulos, CEO of Enerdia.
Kalimera, kalimera se olus.
Kalimera, good morning, Tasos.
Good morning, Akuo.
So we have a lot of things to discuss. It will be an open discussion. I will give the floor to each one of you for some introductory remarks. I will start with Guillaume, if you can say a few words at the beginning, and then we will continue with the Q&A.
Sure. Thank you, Kostas, and thank you for the invitation to talk about this very interesting topic. And PPAs, I think we'll have much things to do today. We are talking about target model and PPAs. I think it's a quite interesting topic because of the period right now that we are experiencing. And if you come back to the fundamentals of the role of the target model itself in Europe, I think we shall come back to that to understand the role of PPAs and the dynamism that it can bring on the Greek market. First, target model was created to develop wholesale markets, integrated wholesale markets, and to benefit from market coupling whenever it's possible. And the consequence of that is to provide electricity prices that are coherent, consistent, and that can bring visibility to all the market players, either producers or end users, consumers, or traders. So for me, this is very important that this framework of PPAs shall be well-defined, and the dynamism, the momentum shall be put. We shall put good dynamism to develop those contractual schemes for producers, and especially renewable energy producers.
Especially this time, because
Yes.
we have two big elements here. How are we going to be financing this very large portfolio of renewable energy projects that they need to come to the market based on the energy transition, let's say, policies that we have, globally speaking, and at the same time, at this environment of very high prices?
Yes.
So I don't know, time-wise, I think it couldn't be a better time to be discussing that and actually initiating it in a relatively new market as well as Greece is. Mr. Cholevas?
Okay, thank you for the invitation. The way the energy market is organized and operates in our country has changed significantly the last 10 years. In the context of the gradual harmonization with the European regulations, the aim of the European Union and of the Greek energy market is to provide reliable, reasonably priced, and with the least possible impact on the environment energy supply to business households through a liberalized electricity market. And that's the key point. PPAs have developed thanks to this liberalization, as they give the opportunity to energy market participants to make bilateral agreements in order to buy or sell amount of energy which will be generated for a predetermined tenure in a fixed price. Till now, corporate PPAs are still mature. However, the role in the forthcoming years is about to be more and more imminent, as the energy market and its participants face many challenges. First of all, internationally, the regulatory regimes for renewable energy projects are being transformed, imposing liberalization which leaves behind guaranteed returns. Furthermore, a significant volume of existing guaranteed price contracts are approaching or have already matured. Additionally, in many countries, among them Greece, the abolition of state aid is already underway or being implemented. In this case, the Irish projects become full market participation, forcing them to seek for effective ways to manage risk and return. Consequently, the financing of renewable projects and their viability are put in a new trajectory, facing the challenge of volatile wholesale prices, especially the last year. At the same time, many European companies and industries are increasingly considering a climate sustainable energy supply as part of their strategy to make their business environmentally sustainable, setting ambitious carbon targets. This leads to increasing demand for green energy to cover their respective needs. And I remind you the ambitious target of net zero by 2050 and, of course, the 2030 threshold. Last but not least, after COVID pandemic, European industries are suffering by surging energy costs and in some cases are forced into shutting down production, while quite few energy retailers are falling over as their hedge cover proves inadequate. All the above demonstrate the necessity of corporate PPAs. As through them, areas, developers, industries with set green targets, industries with high energy consumption costs will need to have access to fixed energy prices. Even the Greek state recognizing the necessity of PPAs in a free energy market and intends to establish a legal framework in order to facilitate the development of an organized PPA market. This will lead to a market with debt liquidity, as the previous speaker said, facilitating the creation of financial products and hedging instruments. Moreover, it will allow secondary trading and funding, crucial aspect of this procedure. MBG, who is market leader on green energy project, has seen the market needs on the energy transition and along with competitive products of financing, has developed last year global market products for managing energy risk. We are the only Greek bank which is able to offer energy hedging products on OTC market for natural gas, for Greek energy electricity and the UAs. So we can deliver an integrated approach to all business aspects of IRS, even if it's the development of it, as we have seen also raw materials, surging prices in the raw materials the last few months. So we can provide hedge solutions either on that and afterwards in order to provide a sustainable and more concrete and stabilized procedure in the whole time of the revenues of the project. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I will pass now to Mr. Georgopoulos to give us his perspective from his point of view of how the market develops. You are developing many solutions regarding aggregation solutions. You own an aggregator as well yourself. Develop the backbone of systems to support the implementation of this market mechanism that we are talking about. How you see things and what is your view on the topic?
Thank you for the opportunity to be with you today and share our experiences. Actually, from the point of view of a platform vendor that operates in several countries, we see the concept of private PPAs as the new driving force that will drive the next generation of renewable developments in the next years. The public subsidies have done well for the years so far, but now the green PPAs or the private PPAs concept is the perfect means for switching gracefully from the previous era to the new era. The good thing with this is that it seems that it opens up the market to unlimited opportunities and players. So the markets are not limited anymore by only the decisions about the public subsidies, but they are rather are open to the appetite of the players. And there are, as our colleague Mr. Cholevas mentioned earlier, there are a number of interesting players taking place in this new ecosystem. They are equity partners, debt providers, designers, market players, and all this stuff. So the private PPAs are the enabling factor for continuing the renewable deployments in an unstoppable manner. And that's from when you look at it from the from the outside, from the inside, from the owner's perspective. Speaking about our majority of clients that are usually owners of PV plants, we see an unprecedented appetite to understand more. So until recently, with the concept of the public subsidies and auction prices, etc., there was the of course, the motive to operate perfectly, a solar plant, generate as much energy as possible, minimize the unavailabilities and maximize the power, etc. But right now, all the international players in Europe, North America, Australia, and so on, they are establishing internal trading teams in their, alongside their previously existing asset management groups. The trading teams are looking to learn what is this all about, what are the prices, what is the day ahead and the intraday and the balancing market, and how they are exposed to risk, and what is the PPA provider that until previously was just a name on a paper and alongside the number. Now they are trying to understand what is their potential participation there. So all these creates a new energy. People are looking around to find the best possible offers from aggregators, optimizers, and so on. But they are also looking internally to see what tools they can use to optimize their fleets of plants, and why not start trading directly against their balance sheet, and taking decisions that, according to the appetite and mandate of each fund, might be more or less applicable to their interests. We see partners or clients with a more conservative style still remaining with the market available players, while others that are willing to take more risk on the equity, they're trying to experiment and see what it is in for them in the new private PPA world.
Perfect. I will pass now to Mr. Machias from Axpo. It's a well-known global, with a very large position in Europe, trader of energy. And this is a word I've heard from all of you. I mean, we used to be simply selling energy, especially for renewable energy producers. Now the key word is we trade energy. So there's a big difference behind it. And I was also mentioned by Mr. Georgopoulos as well just now. So, Mr. Machias.
Indeed. I have actually prepared a short presentation. Would you like me to go through that?
You can use the podium or you can use the clicker if you want to.
Good morning. Indeed, it is my pleasure to present to this prestigious event for the energy market in Greece. As Mr. Andriosopoulos mentioned, I worked for Axpo Solutions. We are a Swiss company. We are based in the city of Baden, just outside Zurich, and we have been in operations for approximately the past 100 years. At the moment, we are active in 31 countries, 40 markets, all across Europe, from Scandinavia in the north, the Mediterranean countries in the south, the UK in the west, and we span across Europe to Poland, Ukraine, down the Balkan Peninsula, Greece, and Turkey east. We also have operations in the United States of America and have recently opened up an office in Singapore to cover the Asian markets. We are a vertically integrated energy company, so we are active across the entire value chain for electricity, from production of electricity to electricity grids, wholesale, supply, trading and sales, smart technologies, and of course, supply to end customers. In the field of PPAs, we pride ourselves on being one of the market leaders. We have a portfolio of a little more than 6.5 gigawatts of renewable energy sources under management all across Europe, wind farms, solar PV, small hydro, biomass facilities. In these slides, I have just tried to give you a snapshot of transactions that we have very recently closed. As you can see, we recently entered into power purchase agreements in countries like the UK, Romania, Poland, Iberia, in Spain and Portugal, Belgium, Scandinavia. We aspire to bring this model to the Greek market as well and are actively seeking to develop a portfolio of utility PPAs in Greece. Many speakers spoke about the benefits of PPAs, which are well known, I believe. For the society as a whole, PPAs can accelerate the transition to the zero carbon economy And quite importantly, they reduce the reliance of developers on subsidy schemes and alleviate the financial burden on consumer bills. For the producers, PPAs can offer a stable and predictable revenue stream. They de-risk future cash flows and can hence enable project financing to take place. Finally, for the off-takers, PPAs, of course, are one of the best ways to reduce the carbon footprint. And they offer a natural hedge against market price volatility, something which is particularly relevant nowadays. See commodity prices and power prices skyrocketing. There are, of course, many, many different types of PPAs, but here we have attempted to summarize what we feel are the most common of those. So when it comes to the off-taker, depending on who the buyer is, I think we can typically distinguish between corporate PPAs, industrial PPAs, and utility PPAs. We, as Axpo, tend to focus on the third pillar. We are a utility, we are the off-taker of electricity on a long-term basis from renewable energy sources. A PPA can be physical in the sense that it will involve the underlying delivery of electricity at the meter of a final consumer, or it can be financial, acting as a financial hedge simply for the purpose of price fixing. PPA can cover 100% of the metered output of an asset, what we typically call as produced PPA, a proportion of it, or a pre-agreed profile, typically an hourly shape or a baseload block of energy. And when it comes to price, here I think there is a lot of flexibility. Fixed price is something that clients regularly ask us for, particularly in immature markets. But as previous speakers mentioned, we see more and more developers or investors now willing to take merchant risk, be exposed to some element of market price risk with an indexation on the pricing. Of course, there are different combinations one can come up with in terms of floors, caps, or a combination of them. Worldwide PPA activity, as we can see on those two charts, has picked up significantly in the recent years. On the left, we see global corporate PPA activity. And as you can see, there's exponential growth in the volume contracted from 2017 to 2020. On the right, we see a monthly tracker of PPA activity in Europe. Quite a bit of variance there on a monthly basis, but this is to be expected. But I think the trend is clear. The trend is an increasing trend. We believe that PPAs are here to stay, and we believe that they are going to have a very important role going forward. In the particular case of Greece, the government has, of course, set very ambitious environmental targets, aiming to double the amount of capacity for wind and solar by 2030. This is already ambitious. We noticed that the national TSO, AVMIE, recently consulted the market an even more ambitious scenario, whereby RES penetration is expected to surpass the national renewable targets by quite a lot. So we are talking here about a scenario where renewables, intermittent renewable energy sources, will form the backbone of the electricity system. And in this respect, it is not a surprise that Greece has attracted unprecedented interest from developers and investors. The Regulatory Authority for Energy announced recently that they have issued more than 4,300 generation licenses, which amount to a total of 81 gigawatts of installed capacity. This is very, very big volumes, of course. It just shows how big of an interest currently Greece is attracting from both local and international investors. The previous support scheme has come to an end. It was an auction in May of 2021, and we are currently awaiting details of what is going to follow next. We understand that the government intends to introduce a new round of auctions, which will award contracts for differences to a total of about 3.1 gigawatts of renewable installation. If we compare this number with the 81 gigawatts of registered interest that we showed in the previous slide, there appears to be quite a large of a gap there that we expect PPAs to help fill. What we are also seeing is that the clearing prices in the CFD auctions are coming down, probably more true for solar PV rather than for wind. But in the last auction, last May, the weighted average clearing price for solar PV was at 37.6 euros per megawatt hour, a record low. And to put things in context, at the same time, we have seen commodity prices skyrocketing. Natural gas in European hubs is trading 250% of what it used to trade 6 months ago. The same is true, more or less, for the price of carbon emissions, which has increased by approximately 200% in the same period. And this, of course, has had a direct impact on electricity prices in Greece. This chart shows the price on the day-ahead market operated by the Hellenic Energy Exchange. As we can see, there has been a significant increase since the beginning of 2021. Power prices are now well above the threshold of 100 euros per megawatt hour, which some time ago would be unheard of. So at these price levels, we believe that the market can actually support and bring forward the development of new renewable sources without the need to resort to national support, simply through the use of bilateral long-term PPAs. But of course, power prices are just one determinant. One also needs to have the ability to forward hedge. And here, things are improving, but it is our view that more can be done. This slide is a courtesy from the European Energy Exchange. It shows the total traded volume in Greece, the period from January 2021 to July 2021, and compares it with the corresponding period of last year. And as we can see, there has been a 233% increase in traded volume in Greece. So this is fantastic news, but for a successful PPA to function, we need a bit more. Currently, liquidity is concentrated on the short-dated contracts, months, quarters, the frontier. One needs to have the ability to forward hedge even further out, something that in other European countries, of course, is common practice. The government has acknowledged that there may be an issue that needs to be addressed. They are putting forward a market reform plan. One of the ideas is to create a platform that will bring together buyers and sellers to encourage contracting on a bilateral basis for PPAs with some form of financial guarantees to be provided by the government insofar as credit risk, counterparty credit risk is concerned. We are awaiting details of that, and I guess this may be important for some of the developers and buyers looking to contract raise PPA. So in conclusion, I would say that as far as Axpo is concerned, we believe that there is a very important role for PPAs in the Greek energy market. As we have seen in other European countries, this is now becoming more and more prevalent. But for that to be successful, there are a few points that need to be addressed, which require the contribution of all market participants. The first and foremost is that we need reliable price signals. We need reliable price signals, not just for the first 12 months, but further out on the forward curve, something that in Greece doesn't exist at the moment. It exists in other European countries, and we hope that we are going to trend towards this direction. We need forward market liquidity to improve as well and not be concentrated only on short-dated products. And this, in turn, requires appetite from all market participants, generators, suppliers, consumers, traders, to commit to long-term prices. So it's not good complaining about the lack of liquidity when very few companies are willing to trade. Finally, I think the banks have a very crucial role to play here. Of course, there must be appetite from lenders to finance projects on the back of a bilateral PPA. And for that, counterparty credit risk will be key. So the buyers need to be able to demonstrate and convince the lenders that they have financial strength, a strong balance sheet required to underpin those long-term liabilities for lenders to be comfortable to finance the projects. So with that in mind, I would like to thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Machias. I will pass now the floor to Mr. Athanasopoulos, who's with us remotely. Mr. Athanasopoulos, as a developer and generally speaking, a service provider of this industry, that we see that there is a huge interest, many licenses being applied for, issued in many cases. A question/comment, I mean, how many of those do you believe that there will be materiality? How many of those projects we may see developing all the way at the end? Plus, of course, the comments that you may have on the new environment that we will be experiencing now with PPAs being seriously part of the life of any renewable energy developer/producer.
Thanks. Thank you for the opportunity. First of all, I welcome everybody in this warm discussion. On your first question, Kostas, I would like to remind everybody that the environmental, the Greek energy environment system and framework is not as friendly as we all were hoping. We all are facing difficulties in terms of developing projects, in dealing with authorities, in diverse environments. So having anyone of us this kind of experience already knows that the development process in Greece is at least much not as good, I would say, as it should be in order to compete other countries such as Spain, Italy, and the rest of Europe. However, despite some adverse situations, we all have managed to attract significant investment opportunities, and we see that there is a very strong appetite for more and more energy. However, coming back to the main topic of our discussion, I see that we are moving to a new world that, first of all, there is no specific framework and a legal framework in terms of the state framework to make something solid in order to anticipate of what should be expected over the next years. We envisage corporate PPAs, we envisage, for instance, energy trading market. There are things still to be solved. However, and this also has to do with how the financial institutes will approve bankability of projects, because now we are moving from small projects to bigger and bigger ones. So traditional valuation systems with internal rate of return not going to further accept it by financial institutes. This is for sure. So at the end of the day, we have to rethink, everybody has to rethink how we conceive the bankability of projects. And from our point of view, we see that we are moving to a traditional, let's say, investment valuation to a real asset valuation. And this has also to do with the mentality of investors, of the energy investors. Having experienced over the last 15 years with prices subsidized by the states, we have seen the investors acting mainly, just to make it light, more than as property investors instead of asset investors. What I mean by that is that sometimes energy investors, not only in Greece but in the rest of the Europe, were acting like buying a house for their late years in order to be rented and provide them some income, as long as the state prices were high. Now, this mentality has to change, because now we're moving to a situation where prices are not fixed anymore. And investors have to make a cultural transformation in order to provide a promise to the buyers. And this, I think, is the most significant part, because promise is defined by if I can produce, when I can produce, and how much. Right now, I'm not very happy to say, but this is the issue. The majority of the investors, of the current investors, are not ready yet to answer all of these three questions and provide a guaranteed promise in such a way that they will create a bankable and credit worth environment for their buyers. Because in order to deliver a promise, in order to deliver a promise about the energy production, you have to know how much you can do it at a specific given time. And in order to do something like that, we have to pass from the traditional, let's say, monitoring systems. We have to evolve, all of us, developers, constructors, investors, everybody, every stakeholder, to transform to and to evolve, let's say, to provide accurate and tangible estimation results. Estimation results not only in terms of now, but also in the next 3 days, 5 days, if possible, next month. And in order to answer that kind of questions, we have to pay more attention to specific KPIs that has to do with the daily OPEX of the projects. I mean about operation and maintenance. Now the traditional operation and maintenance, from my point of view at least, is dead. Because the traditional operational maintenance provides only some annual works just to satisfy manufacturer specifications. Now we have to move from the traditional, let's say, management of projects to finding the exact risk of not producing, mitigate the risk, and make the necessary actions in order to improve the efficiency of the technical teams. We have to go to more contract evaluation analysis about how much someone performs and how he performs. We have to induct operational maintenance experience into databases in order to deliver and keep expertise, not in the hands of the owner, but on the evaluation of the asset. In addition to that, in order to make when and how much questions answered efficiently, we have to induct into our daily mentality advanced weather forecasting models. We have to be very, very solid in our production prognosis, not only in terms of projections, but mainly in advanced statistics models, including machine learning of our database and our models, in order to create as small error in our estimations as possible. From my point of view, I see that we are moving, and this is good, at least to my eyes, we are moving to a more demanding energy world, where the energy investors must evolve in order to be smart asset managers.
Mr. Athanasopoulos, very much. We are back in the correction, yes. I have a question for Guillaume. Which kind of profile would we prefer being a producer? And then I will ask the same question also to Mr. Machias, Vasili, in terms of a trader signing the two counterparties. If you have a producer and a buyer, let's say, of this energy, wind and solar projects have a different profile, obviously. There is the stochastic production element that also Tasos has mentioned for both technologies. Okay, not in a different way. And that's why I would also throw in the question, how then do you think that storage is important in this story?
Yes, from a producer point of view, the key words that was mentioned by the previous speakers is bankability, actually, of the project. So at some point, when we want to sell the electricity coming from our assets, renewable assets, we need to find a way to sell as much as produced possible so that we don't bear a risk of balancing or something like that that will be pushed towards the buyer, the final buyer of the electricity. And as you said, solar, wind, we have to forecast electricity, so sometimes it's higher, sometimes it's lower. So at some point, if we want to propose a load, a production that will be matching the load of the consumer or the retailer at the end, storage assets can be a solution to be put in front of our renewable assets and propose a package, a bundle PPA, assets, renewable assets plus storage, to have a load that could be more suitable to trade for base load or peak load products that could be maybe that could bring more liquidity to the market and that could help us signing PPAs with maybe better prices at the end.
And do you think these storage assets could be viable / bankable on a full kind of merchant way, or would they need also some sort of a capacity mechanism to support with a subsidy, partly at least?
Yes, I think some support should be needed at least to launch this mechanism. And we see that in other countries in Europe and in the world, that full merchant, let's say storage plus renewable assets, are not often viable. We need some support, some capacity mechanism, something that could help the revenues growing in our financial model.
Vasilis?
Yes, I agree with what Guillaume said. What we see in Greece, Kostas, and in other markets, when they started the transition from a fully subsidized regime to corporate or utility PPAs scheme, is that almost the majority of, if not all of the clients, are asking for fixed price, pay as produced long-term PPAs, minimum of 10 years, contract 10. This, of course, is to make the project bankable, to convince the banks that the variability in future revenues is no longer there. All of the risk is transferred to a creditworthy buyer. This is what we have seen so far in Greece as well. But as with every other European market, we believe that after a transitory period, once developers, off-takers, and lenders become familiar with the concept of bilateral PPAs, then the structures will evolve into something simpler along the lines that Guillaume explained. Maybe as a first step, not a full pay-as-produced PPA for 100% of the output, but for 70% of the output with some merchant exposure on the remaining 30%. Then moving into the world of PPAs whereby we agree on a fixed price for a given profile as opposed to all of the electricity generated, and eventually moving to baseload blocks of energy. We understand that in other European countries, lenders are happy to finance solar PV assets on the back of baseload PPA. Of course, in those markets, both lenders and market participants have had a good 15 years of experience with all of the other less risky structures and now have the comfort and expertise to move into something more elaborate.
It seems that this is a bit more recent, let's say, for the Greek market. So we need to, I guess, all market players, including the banks, adapt a little bit faster to this new environment. And with this, I would like to ask Christos, given the fact that the company also has a lot of presence in the U.S., and you know, the U.S. market has liberalized, you know, far before even we started with the European markets, and we have seen these forms of more, let's say, less fixed prices, more risky kind of structures some time ago, and it seems to be working. there is another element there with when we experience high prices, maybe we try to easily blame them, the market, for something happening. But at the end of the day, is it better or is it worse for the market, for the consumer, when these kind of structures exist and you have a free market, a more liberalized market that allows these structures, the form of the PPAs being there for the market players and the consumer at the same time? What is the experience?
We see that there is indeed, as Mr. Machias mentioned, there is indeed some increasing appetite for not only, let's say, 10-year fixed pay-as-produced products, but also some appetite to have some floating part of this PPA and some exposure to merchant prices. Speaking about other countries, it's true that this mix of, say, 70% fixed, 30% floating is something like a reality. The use of a financial hedge provider is very common everywhere in all countries, whereas the producer uses a physical route to market solution to deliver the energy at a completely floating price and hedges all or part of the of that quantity by a virtual or CFD-like contract. And this is the usual structure of the tri-party virtual PPA. So I think that probably in our country, this will be probably the way that things will evolve into. But I fully agree that at the beginning, and for as long as the banks, the lenders, need to get accustomed into this new reality, there may be some tendency for the fully fixed profiles, fully fixed, market prices with PAP profiles. And I believe that the banks, maybe in a year or year and a half, will start adopting more flexible structures as well. I think that the market player here is the bank. I would say that usually the renewables are not market makers or price makers, they are price takers. So price-wise, they don't affect the markets, the consumers, and so on and so forth. It is the established players, the thermal players, and so on, that affect that. And to the extent that lenders can facilitate the way for renewables to be deployed more massively, they will just make, for a better overall pricing for the consumers.
This is exactly what it is at stake here as well. I mean, we have discussed it over the conference over the past 3 days, also with the minister and other market participants and policymakers, that the faster we are able to get into market all these renewable energy projects, the faster then we may see some reduction, first of all, at let's say average level of wholesale prices in the market, plus some volatility because of the fact that as you mentioned, prices are set. So we are price takers, we are not price movers, as may be the case with other forms of generation. But the key question, as you mentioned, the key player may be the banks in this new environment. And the banks, on one hand, they need to adapt in this new energy reality, but they have to accept sometimes things as they go. And the fact that at the end of the day, even after the 10-year tenure or 15 or 12-year tenure or 7, they're all will always be a market, and there will always be a market price. And historically speaking, we have seen that these prices are at a, let's say, relatively fair level, which in many cases are way above the prices that we saw in the tenders. That we not only in Greece, the 33 euro, in other countries, in Portugal, record prices at close to 11 or 10.5 euro per megawatt hour. So, it could make the life of the bank easier to decide. I think that they can accept some prices also in their model after the tenure of the debt. But what are your comments on that, and how NBG is prepared for this new environment?
As I unfolded in my initial thesis, we are the first and the only Greek bank actually now that we have a full capacity of products that we can provide to customers if they are sellers or users, in order to mitigate the price risk, either on a Greek electricity market or on TTF market. And actually, we have already established quite enough liquidity for tenors that we don't see in the actual market. So we provide solutions for Greek electricity for 1 to 1.5 a year beyond, for TTF about 3 years duration, and also the same for the UAE's market. The market is evolving. We have four milestones to surpass in order to be able to actually come to the funding issue. We have liquidity problems, we have duration problems for the PPAs, credit problems, and actually all that ultimately comes to the funding. Funding is the main issue. As a bank, we have perceived this problem, and now, as being the first bank that were actually in the market about 3-4 years, we are now deploying and starting to building the framework in order to be ready to fund and to leverage such a project here in Greece. So we are now developing the framework in order to be able to have to be the intermediate on financial PPAs in order to give also the opportunity to fund these projects.
I would connect this to a discussion we had last night with a fund manager in the United States in Chicago regarding ESG, and you know, ESG is a big trend, and I connect that because it's quite important. We are talking about investments in renewable energy. We know that the focus is on the E side, meaning the environment and what actions can we take there. And there is always, from an investor's point of view, the concept of how can I green my supply chain to be net zero, I need to invest in renewables or to buy green energy. So it all leads again to how fast can we actually build those projects. So for me, it seems that, you know, capital is there. We're talking about trillions of dollars that are mobilized around this industry, around this sector. And it's just a matter of the banks actually to go out from the traditional model, not in terms of the financing and the numbers and the model to work, but in terms of structuration. It's just we need to think a little bit smarter, act somehow differently than what we used to be doing in the past, in-house only and internally, and try to look outside, because there is a lot of capital outside that could be used for mezzanine equity, for to bridge the gap that may face as a problem for someone to be able to accept the new terms that you may be asking. So you could also be the facilitator of that and bring the solution on the table. So that's another, you know, something that I have been thinking of some time now that you can take away as a food for thought and see how this could be developed, let's say, better. But I keep the problems on the, you know, duration, as you said, might be an issue. But as I said, you know, electricity will be needed forever.
Yes.
We cannot do anything without it. So there will be a market out there. Prices will be there. So I don't see, you know, duration being an issue. You fix a PPA for 5 years, then you go merchant. Yes. Shouldn't be a problem. What do you think?
I would agree with you, but this is not what we are seeing from clients at the moment. As the off-taker, we see an increasing demand for completely de-risking the revenue stream. I think this will be an important first step. Once we are past this step, hopefully before or within the next 12 months, then we will start seeing the structures you have described.
So you believe that we need to crack the market to have the first contracts, see what they look like? They will be probably, you know, 10 years fixed with a fixed price, and then we will see the floor and upside, or 70-30, and so on.
Yes, absolutely. I believe that currently the key players, at least the Greek players, are not very well accustomed with the whole model. It's not just about pricing, it's about contracts, clauses, damages, termination provisions. There is a vast amount of work that needs to be done there to make every party comfortable, lenders, the developer, the off-taker, that this is a chain that works smoothly. and that risks are allocated proportionally to each party, proportionally to the role that each party plays in this equation. I think we are getting there, and to be honest, if you asked me the same question 12 months ago, I would have answered that there's a long way to go before we can contemplate a PPA of this type in Greece. Now I think that it's getting closer and closer, and it's a matter of months.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's also a matter of a couple of months, I guess, or a few months for the Greek market to be able to showcase that you know, this can work. We have had some announcements. We need to really see in action some of these first PPAs. I will turn to Tasos just for a comment, because you know, we said there's a big number of projects out there that has been licensed. We have a scheme, as was nicely presented by Vasilis, from the government announced in terms of auctions. The capacity obviously is much less than the capacity that we envision to meet the National Energy and Climate Plan over the next 10 years, by 2030 at least. And I hear from many producers that they would easily prefer not to go to auctions because the competition seems to be quite high for this limited auction capacity and the very large number of projects that we have, and actually turn into PPA. So at the end, do you think it would make sense? Or why would the auctions should be there? And if yes or no, should we lower or increase the capacity? What is your view on that?
First of all, because it was mentioned earlier about storage, I think storage is a key point for further success in the market. However, let me underline that despite that, than it was expected, the grid utility here in Greece doesn't have a clue about how they will use storage in their system. For instance, not even ADME or the VA has started yet a project or even a pilot project to see how to induct a storage into the system. So I would also expect to see something moving also from the grid utility side. Now, coming back to what is already discussed, as I said in my first discussion, first speech, I see a completely different valuation system of the process. And the key question, of course, has to be answered by the financial institutes, because now the main question is how the banks will perceive the debt service ratio. Because right now we have a debt service ratio that is calculated over the debt life, having in place a fixed PPA, and now the same officers will have to answer a different question when it has to be with 5-year PPAs or 10-year PPAs with much less prices, and the debt service ratio limit will be much, much higher than it was expected. So I don't know how they will perceive the bankability of the projects. This question was also been placed in Cyprus, if you remember well, 5 years ago, when they started moving away from the traditional fixed PPAs, and the banks there also faced the same problem. And I think that you all know that in the first years of construction projects, it was asked for a 100% investment by the investors, until the banks starting to also accepting to finance as well.
And for the auctions, what is your view on the auctions and the scheme? I mean, do you think that for the market it would be better for auctions to stay there for longer, bigger capacity, or is it the time now to actually get away from them and move to the market as we are discussing?
I don't think that the Greek market is ready yet to go anywhere without the auction. Not yet. From what I see that without a legal framework, without, let's say, a solid proposal by the financial institutes, without knowing exactly what is the grid capability, we cannot move away from the auctions. at least not yet, not for the next, let's say, 2 years. At the same time, as I said, we have to also make some actions in order to change the mentality from property investors to asset investors, and to transform the investors from being able to deliver a promise for the investments that they make, because otherwise they are not investors if they cannot be solid on what they promise and when it is promised. This will also help the banks to make better decisions in which projects they will finance or not. At the end of the day, I expect that until the end of 2022, auctions will still move, will still work, despite the fact that the appetite of the market is that they would continue for the next 3, 4, or 5 years if possible. There is a fight. There is a fight between the European Union and between the lenders and the buyers.
Okay. Thank you, Tasos. Because we have limited time left, I want to go to a softer, let's say, point to make. We talked about skills and teams that they are necessary for all these organizations in the supply chain that we're discussing, from producers to the traders, the buyers, aggregators, more specialized players, I mean, the banks. Do you think that we, first of all, we know that we have the capacity, but what needs to be done? Because with my academic capacity, I believe that there is an extreme need for training of not only the young generation and the people that we have, the resources that we already have, to give them the necessary skills to take us through this. We talked about brain regain even with the previous speakers, with the Minister of Transportation. We have Greeks abroad, New York, Geneva, London, they're all working in the big names, the trading houses. I'm sure they would be willing to work here if there is a good opportunity. So I think it's up to us to, let's say, make it happen. But if I may go around and have a quick comment, like 30 seconds from each one of you. If I start with Guillaume, yeah. It's not relevant for the Greek HR, but for the first part of the question mostly, I guess.
Yeah, for the first part of your question, I think we see more and more things related to energy trading, energy markets in educational programs to train people to have a different view of the job. I think energy sector has changed a lot for the past few years. And we need to adapt. We need to train people to be able to cope with all those challenges that will accompany the energy transition in the future years. And as you said earlier, we talk about trading, not selling electricity anymore. So our jobs have changed. We need to adapt and to be able to find the right way to convince all our partners, from banks to off-takers, that the new schemes are sufficient and bring confidence to develop our projects.
Actually, we've seen legislation coming forward to the market. So the market must be adaptive and quick. So we're a learning curve, correct, but it's a very steep curve to our world. So we see many players coming and giving also the mentality, the education material that we want. And as more participants are in the market, it will be more easier for the years to come.
Indeed, the same way we saw renewables transforming a number of sectors, starting from the land surveyors to construction people and so on and so forth, then asset managers, operators, etc. And by the way, in that topic, several people have returned to our country from abroad, where they have gained experience in all these topics. Now there is this new chapter coming up with people having exposure in all these sorts of energy markets that until previously were sort of foreign to renewables, but now they are becoming so naturally linked together. So with renewables becoming a core energy player and not a, let's say, a small player of the past with very peculiar handling and so on, I think that all of the market opens up now. The academic opportunity is there for both, and extending the academic program towards generalized introduction of energy trading in all sectors, and the opportunity for brain regain is obviously there alive and kicking with many players, employees of foreign companies seeing the opportunity to relocate again in Greece and find, you know, all those highly sophisticated jobs available in their country as well.
I agree with all of the previous speakers. I think there is a unique opportunity for Greece when it comes to transition. I personally have been around for a long time. I haven't seen such interest from foreign investors and developers ever. Every day we are being approached by yet another major global investor interested in investing in renewables in Greece. Of course, many European players, lots of Greeks work for them, but also let's not underestimate the extremely highly skilled personnel that one can find in Greece. All we need, I think, is the trigger to move to this new era that has already happened in other European countries, and everything else will follow.
Tasos, 10 seconds, please, for you, because we are...
Globalization and put all moving around from country to country has brought us great engineers, great finance managers, great evaluators. I think that we have to combine all of them in a new era where everybody will have more energy economics in their blood. Engineers understand more finance, and finance to understand more engineering. I think the new era will bring stronger teams to better communicate to one another.
Excellent. Thank you all very much.
You are at the epicenter.
We're at the epicenter, yes. Thank you for this great discussion. I hope we can repeat that next year with more news and a lot of projects and examples to illustrate that it has been done. So with this, I would like to thank you again.
Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.